Let us join our hearts together in prayer. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditation in all of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength, our rock, our redeemer. Amen. Our first scripture passage today is from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. Listen now as God speaks to us through God's word. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, I will tell you what I will do. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem, the people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard than I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its walls, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste, and it shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed. Righteousness, but heard the cry. May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirits. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I took Latin for a couple of years in high school. Any Latin people here? I love Latin. I don't remember a whole lot about it, as most languages are the first 2 weeks, and then after that it gets kind of a little bit hazy, but I remember the phrase in vino veritas. Anyone ever heard that? It is wine, there is truth. And that is to say that, they say this in Rome and other times, that it's said that someone has perhaps had too much wine, they're more likely to speak the truth. In this song, it's called the Song of the Vineyard, the Song of Vines, and the Song of Grapes, and the yield. Nice vintage. The Song of the Vineyard, there is a higher truth. There is love, and there is hope, and there is disappointment, and at last, there is anger. It starts off, let me sing a song for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. The poetic language, you have to read through a couple of times with a lot of poetry to really understand what is being said, but it is the prophet who is speaking for God, speaking for the beloved, talking about his vineyard, talking about the people of Israel. But there is that question of who is speaking, who is the beloved, and who is, or what is going on with the vineyard. God is the lover in this tune, the owner of the vineyard. The people are Judah and Israel, and it's a love song, but it's not the kind of love song I would listen to when I was growing up. It's not the saccharine sweet bubblegum pops up the racing on the radio. It's a love song, but it's definitely not an easy listening tune. It's a story of unrequited love, a sad song, singing so much. The owner, he digs, and he clears, and he plants, and he protects, and he waits. And he's hopeful that all this work that he's done is going to yield a harvest. There's going to be a return of all this time and his loving. He wants choice grapes, and they never came. He loved, but the love was never reflected. I'm reminded of all those farmers in Oklahoma and Kansas and Texas and Mexico and in the corner of Colorado in the 1930s. They planted and they prayed. Toiled and they tilled, they waited and hoped, only to be met with disappointment. And so the phrase was used all the time in the 1930s, but maybe next year. Maybe next year it's going to rain. Maybe next year the winds won't blow as much. Maybe next year there won't be so much dust. Maybe next year. Many left for California with the promise of work, but more stayed and tried to make the land live and work again. Maybe next year, but for a decade, all that was met on the Great Plains was dust and disappointment. God, it says in this beautiful, hard love song, he says, he expected justice. The Hebrew word for that is mishpat, and he saw bloodshed instead of justice. And the Hebrew word there is mishpat. It's just taking out one little letter. It's beautiful. It loses something in the translation, but on one side it is justice when he sees bloodshed. It's expected justice, but God did justice. The righteousness is to God. But her cry is the Zakah, which is to say that in the original Hebrew, again, this beautiful poetic language that we don't completely get the translation, but it's saying, I expected one thing, but you gave me back something else. Even the most beautiful word, like even the most beautiful songs, are not always easy tunes to hear. There is a vineyard that God has created, it's God's people, it's God's plan that this people produce something good, but instead they produce bitter grapes, wild grapes, useless grapes, rotten grapes. In this passage and in the next, God is tired of waiting. And that is the question, really, and really what is going on in Israel at that time. It's preparing for invasion, it's preparing to be occupied. The prophet is saying, you need to turn around, you need to turn around. And the last thing it says, judgment is coming. What has happened with the people, the backstory on this is the wealthy few have been absentee landowners. They have walled off the countryside so the common people cannot go in farm. The common people cannot go in and work. And so the prophet says that God sees this, and God, while looking for righteousness, hears only cry. And so we turn to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verse 49 through 56. And Jesus is talking here, and he says, I came to bring fire upon the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think I have come to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, five in one household will be divided, three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother. Mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. He also said to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say it is going to rain, and so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be scorching heat. And so it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? May this God's word speak to our hearts, our minds, our spirits. This too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This is not the Jesus we are conditioned to think of. We do not expect this Jesus when we look at the Bible. It's not the Jesus that has a lamb on his shoulder, a child on his knee. This is a Jesus that has more angst and anger, more fire, and more fury. This passage, which sometimes we gloss over, and that's what I like about the lectionary, because it keeps us honest. This is not an easy first passage, it's not an easy second passage to read, but it is God's word. It is a real Jesus that is here. It is an honest Jesus, a Jesus by this point who is completely fed up. He has no more patience. He keeps talking to people, but they don't hear him. They don't follow him. He's well into his public ministry. At this point, he knows what's going to happen. He knows there is a cross. He knows at the end of this. He knows time is of the essence. And so he is letting the people, and letting us, hard as it is to hear. He's basically saying, I'm giving you everything and I've seen nothing returned. He's talking about people who are so quick to rush to judgments and be judgmental, but don't rush to do justice. And there's bloodshed and there is crying. He's saying, this is not a thing that is everybody pulling me in. This is a hard truth. But to put it another way, maybe more lighthearted way, is I walked out of my house this morning and I felt good. That's why I've been 3 months and I felt good. When you feel the coolness in the air, then you know it's still a little August. You know that it's not going to last. But just for a moment, you know that fall is coming. You know that the cooler nights will be here soon enough. When I walked out this morning, the song kept coming to my head, was, oh Lord, what a morning. We have those times, and these long days of summer where our hearts shall long for what is next in the harvest. Jesus says, you can read the weather, but you cannot see the signs of the times. We know the weather. We know it comes here long enough. You know the patterns. You know when it's humid or what that means. You know the wind blows from the north or from the south. We read those things. We feel the winds, but we don't always know what is going on around us. We have ears to hear and eyes to see, but we are so often deaf. The needs of the world, or even the needs of the person sitting next to us in the pews, are still living next to us in our community, blind to them. And so Jesus talks about being so fed. I remember later on in Jesus' ministry, he sees a fig tree. Right, he curses this fig tree. Sometimes we forget and fully divine Jesus. We have a fully human Jesus as well. A fully incarnated Christ on this earth that feels the same things we do, yearns for the same things we do, perhaps better things than we do. And so we go back to Isaiah. Isaiah talking about the psalm and the man talking about fruit that is good that God has planted. It's not an uncommon theme in the Old Testament or the New Testament. In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus tells the disciples, tells us, you will know other people by their fruits. You're going to know them by what fruit they produce. If you don't expect to see figs from thistles or grapes gathered from thorns, good trees bear good fruit, bad trees bear bad fruit. You will be known by their fruits. We have all these things also in Galatians 5, and perhaps my favorite one of their passages. It's talking about the fruit of the Spirit. It's like, well, how do I bear fruit? What does it mean to bear fruit? This is one of those abstract things, but the fruit of the Spirit are love. Are you filled with love? Are you filled with peace and patience and kindness and generosity and gentleness and self-control? Are you filled with these things? And if we are preparing good fruit, if we are like trees planted by streams of water. If we live by the Spirit, Galatians tells us, let us be guided by the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, beat against one another, envying one another. See, basically, prune those things, cut those things out of our life because they're not producing good fruit. Cesar Chavez, many of you, most of you, we all even know him and his work in California and in the Southwest. He once said, the fight is never about grapes or lettuce, it is always about people. It's never about the produce. This is an example that Isaiah uses, this is an example Jesus and John the Baptist use. It's never about grapes or lettuce or any kind of produce. It's always about people. It's always about people. The Bible is God's love song for God's creation. Remember Genesis chapter 1, and we hear that on the first day of God did this, the second day of God did that. And for those 6 days, and at the end of 6 days, what did he do? He looked at all he had done and said, it's good. He made creation good. And yet, we know creation rebelled against the Creator. And yet, we know, well, there should be justice. There should be something like, well, God's kingdom on earth. We know that there is cries and pain. And so, we come to church to hear these words, these hard words, this hard love song. But we proclaim that love is patient and kind, and love is not insist on its own way, it's not envious, boastful, or rude. We want to know what love is, we look to the gardener, we look to the minister who going to encumber you and run with perseverance the race that before you. Take off those things that keep you from going the way God wants you. God, love protects. Told the pastor, love built the watchtower in the middle of the vineyard. The love protects us, but also love refines us. Other examples that are used are gold or silver is refined. There are times in the fire. There are times in struggle. There are times where we wonder where God is. But even at those points, in those times, God is still refining us. He's purifying us. He's taking off those things. If we let God take off those things. But the lesson is that love falls for return. Any investment is made so there might be a return. Financial, emotional, spiritual. Every investment that God makes in us, God wants to see us bear fruits. Fruits worthy of his time. And the one thing I love about human Jesus, even though there is anger, even though there is frustration, there is such a realness, but there is a solidarity, right? Because the worst thing about when we feel alone is when we're alone by ourselves. The worst thing is that when we're struggling only by our solitary selves. We've all thrown love into the wind and we're disappointed when it didn't return. We've all planted our lives in someone else or in something else, and it's not giving back what we expected. And perhaps that is where you are right now. I don't know where you're at right now. It doesn't matter our age. There's things at work where we work hard but we're underappreciated or we're underrecognized. Perhaps parents and parents of children who are prodigal, children who have gone off and we're longing, waiting for a reading, praying for reconciliation. There are those who have gone through divorce and still have that feeling, that crushing feeling of missed expectation, but also the glance to other people or the comments of wondering what are people saying behind my back. The health of failing bodies, our failing minds, or even death, and that final thing, the ultimate loss. And we wonder, where is the return on love and all of this? I believe our inability oftentimes to love is often rooted in our inability to love ourselves or to accept God's love in our life, to feel that we're lovable, to feel that we are worthwhile. And so we might produce little or might produce nothing. If we cannot accept God's love, we are unable and incapable of giving it and sharing it to somebody else. That's why I love, and I know we're talking about fruit and all these wonderful things and grace and great things you can make there, but I love the dandelion. I love the dandelion because the dandelion exists to make more dandelions, right? We might hate them in our garden, we might hate them in our yard, especially in the spring, but when the air picks up, the little seeds and cast them out into the wind. That's what the DNA does, is to share itself completely with others. And the good news of Christ, that is the story. This is not the end of the story, but the story goes on. It's not the end of the album, but this is a song in it. But the song and the album, the music continues to go on about a God who is making and remaking the world. About a God who sees the world, hears the world. This should be an encouragement. And even though the cries of God hears, remember in Exodus, that is the cries of the Israelites are under oppression, that God hears and God intervenes. This is why the pleas are so passionate in this passage and others. And finally, this is why God cares. That though we might feel like we're alone individually or collectively, God has not given up on God's people. There is solidarity in suffering because the one true and real God engages the world. The song of Christmas is short. It's not really sweet. It's not easy to listen to, but it is real. The song is over, but the singing continues. This isn't the only verse of God's symphony of creation and redemption and finally, thank God, reunion. It's up to us to sing back and praise. It is up to us to sing back and working for justice. It is up to sing back by promoting righteousness. So let us sing and let us grow. Let us bear good fruits and let us
us multiply this message of God's love.